Morning again. As you are aware, we are now really running behind the schedule. Therefore, I request all the panelists to keep it really short. And one of the panelists, he wants to go early, so you can start.
I would like to thank the business world for giving the opportunity to interact with all of you. So this is regarding the new education policy. I have one or two points which I would like to tell you. That is, one is that it's a policy, a voluminous report. I would say that this is rather a compilation of all what is happening, what has been happening, and what is being discussed in the academic circles. So I just wanted to ask everyone one question. What is it that we are going to achieve by this policy? What is the outcome? Because we know, talk about everything about outcome-based education. What is that we are going to achieve? See, at this point, I would like to point out that we have a Vision 2035 document, which has been produced by the TIFAC, that is the Department of Science and Technology, again by the government. It has on education, energy, health, transportation, food and agriculture, and manufacturing. These are the six sectors on which this vision document has been produced. It talks about several things like artificial intelligence, capability of a machine to initiate intelligent human behavior, thorium-based power reactor, personalized medicines, wearable devices, robotic surgical systems, flying cars, fuel cells, waterless processors, zero emissions, bioconcrete, and things like that, including precision agriculture, robotic farming, etc. So, will our education policy, the question here is that, will it gear up to achieve the statements which we have made in the Vision 2035 document? If we are able to achieve that, if the policy document is suitable for that, then we are successful. I just the question is that they have also mentioned several grand challenges in the document. Will we be able to achieve that? At this point, I just would like to point out, probably 50 years back, Amartya Sen said that there is a crisis in our education system and our policy is created for the aspiration of the middle class. So, take the example of Israel, a country which spends 7% of the GDP on education and more than 4% on research. They have achieved, which we should achieve. I mean, they have achieved much better way. Probably they have now excess water, where there is no water, where they have cyber security. The checkpoint is the biggest company in that respect. Maybe technology-assisted agricultural farming. All this, the Israel could achieve it. So, probably this education policy clearly mentions about establishing of a national research foundation where the funding which is proposed is, I think, now the budget is, which is very much less. So, only point here is that until and unless our spending increases to the level of other developed or other countries which have shown real progress in education and technology, our spending has to increase, which will be the only way by which we can get into the point. The second point which I would like to mention is that, again, regulation and governance. See, in 1990, our former Prime Minister said about Indian economy that it is over-regulated and under-governed. Probably now the regulation part is being talked in the new education policy that, again, we are going to have one regulator and we are aggregating all regulators as one. So are they going to be a regulator or are they going to be a something which will facilitate, as the AICT chairman has been telling in all meetings, that AICT is going to be a facilitator rather than a regulator. So, will this happen in the new education policy, what is contemplated is the higher education authority and things like that. See, or are we going to, going to practice the rote learning which we are practicing at the moment. See, production of studious but creativity challenged youths. So that is what really lacks in our education system, lack of creativity that rewarded studiousness over independent thoughts. So how this autonomy can be taken by the university system? The number of colleges, which is now 40,000, which may have to be reduced to a large extent. But what will happen to the colleges is something which we have got to see. See, something like whether we go in for a cluster-based system where colleges will be grouped and under one umbrella, or will acquisition and merger will happen, or will these colleges will cater to a different system of education, of skill development, or community colleges, and we will have only right educations. I mean, it is not necessary that everybody should have a higher education system where you have, which leads to research. I mean, all this, universities will have to cater to the research, but at the same time, it is not necessary that all will be doing very high fundamental things. Maybe these colleges may have got to be converted as community colleges or skill improving centers or something like that. So how this autonomy, what the new system envisages, how can it get into the system of improving the creativity among the students? So I do not know whether increasing 1 year in the school education system will really improve the whole scenario. I mean, I think that is the proposal, that it's has to be another 1 year increase is already proposed in the system of this one. So, I mean, I just wanted only these 2 points to be made because of the lack of time. Thank you very much.
No, now I request Dr. Vaidhyasubramaniam from Sastra University to kind of share his thoughts.
Thank you very much, distinguished co-panelists and members of the audience. The 5 minutes that I have, I would like to make my observations on the NEP very simple and short. We are in Chennai, and Chennai is a land that has seen Singham 1, Singham 2, and Singham 3 in the form of 3 movie versions. So we believe in different versions of the same issue. So we had the education policy. The first one in 1968 was when the education was in the union list. And the second one that came in 1986, followed by a program of action of 92, is when education was the concurrent list. So these two really made a difference, because the issues that had to be handled was very diverse across the diverse community of learners and teachers that our country had. Now the third draft education policy that we are seeing is actually also after a very major constitutional amendment, the RTE. And the policy that we are discussing today has to accommodate a lot of emerging issues that not only confront the Indian ecosystem, but have to address the aspirational dreams of learners, faculty, who are trying to position themselves as finished inventory in a global ecosystem where they need to find their careers properly fixed in place. So that's the perspective with which this entire exercise started, to see how India can be more a contributor than a consumer in the education space. We have a very great legacy of also being a contributor in the education space, but somewhere we lost that and then became consumers in the last 200 years. And now we need to again reinvent ourselves as a contributor in the education space. And every country will have its problems. It's not that the education is all that good in different countries. And that's why, usually state this, one of my friends' observation on all these policies, especially the 5-year plans. If you look at the first draft of the 12th 5-year plan, it would just be similar to the 12th draft of the first 5-year plan. So it again starts with the same problems. So every country will have its own problems. And education being a very critical social sector entity, we also have our problems. But then if you look at the history of education, at least the post-independence, we have really made good progress in moving forward. We had some of the best institutions established. Then there was capacity building. And when you build a capacity in formal education, definitely you have to have proper regulatory mechanisms to ensure that the quality is in place. So now we are entering into the third stage where after capacity building, as was articulated forcefully by the speakers in the previous session, now the accent is on quality. And how the role of regulators are going to change by being more a facilitator in our quest for quality in academic pursuits. Now, the two game-changing decisions, shall I say, or the policy vehicles in this NEP, there are many, but the next 2 minutes is only on these two game-changing policy vehicles. One is on teacher education. Yesterday, we celebrated the Teacher's Day. So I find that the proposal to do away with these unitary teacher education institutions and rather bring teacher education as part of a multidisciplinary higher education institution and in the university ecosystem will be doing more good to the teacher education system, because that is the only interface that connects school education with higher education. And on that score alone, the move to completely abandon this legacy and outdated concept of single teacher education institutions will definitely be a game changer, because we need to scale these initiatives, and scaling is possible at the teacher education level, because the problems in school education is actually more than what we see in higher education. And once we go and address the issue of teacher education, we are addressing problems that on either sides of the education, both school as well as higher education. The second is on the proposed NRF, the National Research Foundation. There, one interesting observation coming from a private university background myself, they are now removing the discriminatory link. Usually, research means was assumed that it will happen in public institutions, while private did not have a major share in the research grants. But the move to completely eliminate those differences and make sure that competitive performance-based research is encouraged, whether they are public or private institution, is something that needs to be welcomed. Because I find again that research, which many say is not happening, but we have seen in the last few years that many of the schemes that were articulated before have had a singular agenda of moving or elevating institutions themselves to the next level of research. And you will see that notably in the way in which the higher education institutions are going to categorize themselves as category 1, 2, and 3, and I'm not going to elaborate on that, research and teaching institutions, good teaching institutions, and then the category 3 institutions, which are just at the undergraduate level degree granting institutions. But the major transformation that's happening there is we're going to get away with the affiliating system, where the category 3 institutions by themselves will become autonomous institutions and will aspire to be category 2, and category 2 aspiring themselves to become category 1. The major recognition, coming back to NRF, is that private institutions are also for public good, is a big recognition that the private higher education system is receiving from this NEP. So I'll stop with my initial observations on these two game changers on teacher education, and then making private institutions also, accommodating private institutions also into this pursuit of building a very good educational ecosystem in our country. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vaidya. It's very, very sharp and very relevant also, because the teacher education, it's more little complex in Tamil Nadu, because we also have a separate university also. So that way We have to really kind of dismantle that and really make it multidisciplinary. On your suggestions on, of course, on the research, now, you know that it is always good to involve, but considering the competitiveness of the public or the state universities with the private universities, they have their own disadvantages. Like, the tendering processes or the audit issues, those things, normally you don't face that. So therefore, it is very, I fully agree that it's very good initiative. But at the same time, we have to have some kind of balancing between both, because both contribute to the nation building, no doubt about that. So thank you for your presence. Now I invite KREA University Vice Chancellor, Dr. Sunder.
Thank you, Mr. Sharma, and thank you to Business World for giving us this opportunity. I agree with a lot with what Vaidhyasubramaniam said, but let me just elaborate a few more on my reading of the NEP. In my professional capacity, I'm a development economist, so I look at this from that vantage point, not just as a vice chancellor. And I've always felt that we as a country have produced really excellent students, but the average median student doesn't get the opportunities that we should be giving to that in any state or at the center. And I think when one of the things that was gratifying when I read this report is this emphasis on increasing the GER and making up for what I think historically as a percentage of GDP we spent so less on education relative to even some of the developing countries in Africa and Latin America, that finally we are trying to address that. But the question comes back to follow through, right? So we have had other commissions like the Kothari Commission who have said these things. So I'm very optimistic that we will follow through, because time is now right and ripe for India to reclaim its position as an educational powerhouse. This is one sector which has been neglected, in my view, relative to other sectors where we have proven ourselves in the last 20 years, at least since 1992 reforms. So it's gratifying that finally NEP. So what are the things that attract me about it? One is the focus on quality. As an economist, I think of the three O's. Output, outlays, and outcomes. And given our planning environment, we used to always talk about how many schools have we built, how many crores of rupees have we spent. But we never really have thought about what is the quality of all those investments and what is the outcomes. Have they matched the investments we have made? So I think quality is something every average university, not just the elite universities, but every average university should worry about: quality of students, quality of curriculum, quality of faculty. So quality is very important from that standpoint. The second word I liked in the draft document is autonomy. Is the fact that we might be highly over-regulated, and regulation is important. Every country has regulators and accreditors, but autonomy is equally important. But flip side of autonomy is holding people accountable, so that these universities are not fly-by-night operations. Because education is such a long-term investment you make that you don't want. The public good nature has to be accountable, whether it's a public university or a private university. And I come from a private university world, and I agree with Vaidhi that both universities actually contribute to national building. And so I was very impressed when we had the fortune of Mr. Venkai Nadu launching KREA University last November. And at luncheon, he was talking about how he would like to sort of address this divide that exists and try and bridge the divide between public and private, as long as they're good. To me, that is important. Are you a good university? Are you doing good work? And the ones who are not, haul them up, hold their feet to the fire. So accountability is very, very important if you give autonomy. And so I think the NEP is really coming of age in 2019, what India needs to be in terms of GER, in terms of percentage of GDP that should be devoted to education, because we are addressing the past shortfalls. And of course, if we start doing it today, we still have to continue doing it, because you can't just do it for 1 year or 2 years and leave it at that. And I think the last thing is maybe something that governments cannot do. It's really all of us. It's holding a mirror to us. We all want our children to be taught by good teachers, but none of us really want to send our kids to be teachers or professors, right? So how do we as society bring back this idea of teaching, whether it's at the school level, which is very critical, but then higher education too? How do you bring back the respectability that the professoriate, the academy, the teachers deserve? And you can do that. Countries have shown how to do it. It's not just money. It's the freedom. It's also making the judgment that is important, right? So we can't just have government, even the most well-crafted NEP, cannot get us as people to say we will do our needful in what respectability of gurus used to be. Many of us really don't think as that as a first one, two, three, four options. We would rather have our student go into, a child go into some second or third tier occupation rather than say, let us become teachers. And of course, once you get into the profession, then of course, as I said, my accountability argument, teachers also have to live up to it. You can't just be teaching the curriculum from 10 years back. You can't not do research. And so teacher accountability and teacher education. So it's a symbiotic cycle. But I think we have reached a point, and my last point is, I think 2019, India deserves an education for the 21st century rather than for the 1990s. And it's a multi-stakeholder approach between universities, state governments, central governments, parents, teachers, faculty, and ultimately the person who we are all interested in, which is the student, right? So start with student-centered, faculty-led, regulated in a way. I think that's really what I'm hoping for the NEP to actually translate into action from what I think are actually very good words on paper. So I'll stop here.
Thank you, Sundar. It's really highly relevant two, three points. And I'm very happy that you raised the accountability issue, because this is something which we don't hear from the academicians. Normally, they would say we want more freedom, freedom, and freedom. And the accountability is an issue. The responsibility and accountability both go hand in hand. And we have examples where some of the VCs have done the finest work in public universities. Unfortunately, we have got the other side also where things have not been that good. And also, as you know, government ended up in taking up one of the finest university which was running so well, but unfortunately because of some mismanagement. So therefore, this is really, really relevant that we develop some kind of self-regulation or something, or whatever, some kind of rules for yourself, so that it can be self-sustainable. That kind of model is there. So thank you very much. Now I invite Vice Chancellor from Saveetha University, Dr. Sharma.
And I am thankful to the organizer for the opportunity to present my views. I've got two strong views. One is that a degree is a degree is a degree. Similarly, a university is a university is a university. Why we have reservations like Central University, State University, and now we are starting something like INIs and all that? See, once we are making a policy for the country, in that policy, we should be, I think, giving equitable representation to all the stakeholder universities. We should not differentiate. See, if you go to a government body like DBT or DST and all that, rules are different for private universities, rules are different from government universities, central universities, state universities. Let us break this barrier. Let us not create reservations amongst universities. That's my first point, which I want our persons to note, that in case we can still debate on this issue. I think it's a very, this funding is a very important thing. Like the university which I belong, we promote transdisciplinary research. We are mainly into healthcare. And we also are very much concerned about innovations in outcome-based learning. So once we are doing such good work, we should be funded also by the government. Because ultimately, we are churning out some students which are even preferring us over government colleges and all that. I was very happy when, despite the large fees which we are charging, I am happy that people are still preferring us. And the seats in the government institutions are empty, and the seats in our institutions are full. That reflects on the quality of education. My second point is on accreditation. See, every day we have got IQACSL and all that, dean accreditation, filled with all sort of pressures. Write data for NARF, write data for NARC, write data for QS. So similarly, I think we should have a depository where we just go on putting our total outcome of the university, and whosoever agency is giving accreditation, they can just pick up the data from that and give us accreditation. Let us not waste time of academicians and researchers in this type of activity that half of the time we are engaged in that. So these are my two points, and I'm very happy that our chairman has proposed that he wanted to have a small meeting on research. Sir, I propose if you can consider us to host it, we'll be very happy to host it.
Sure. Thank you. No, thank you. And really, no, your both issues are very relevant. And the differentiation of these universities is already, you know, kind of fading away. It will take some time. But already, I think the thinking is there, as you can see in the new education policy, like where, you know, under the NTRF, everybody is equal. Now, under institutions of eminence, you know that both public everybody is finding a place. So therefore, that that barriers, these are going, but yes, maybe the terminology, so to say, if it can be changed, that maybe perhaps it can be done. And on the other point of which you mentioned just now about the government colleges filling and all, perhaps I think it is more to do with the brand name, which, because many of the people know, they are not aware of this thing. And government, some of the institutions are really good, but they are not able to market themselves. So that's why those kind of, I was discussing with the ICT chairman also, he also mentioned many of these, our own, including Anna University seats, are going vacant, while, you know, some of the not so good, of course you are one of the finest universities, so we know, don't have any issues on that, but some of not so good, even they are able to attract because they are able to meet the student, they are able to, you know, kind of canvas, for so to say, and they are able to kind of do that. So therefore, we are aware of these challenges, and government should come out with some kind of level playing field between these kind of private government and this deemed universities kind of. Thank you. Now I request, I think, last panelist to now come out with this thing. I'm trying to keep it very brief because we are trying to make up the time which we kind of overshot in the inaugural session.
Thank you. Good afternoon, and thanks for another opportunity for sharing my thoughts. I'll confine my thoughts only on the NEP, whether it's a game changer for higher education or not. I firmly believe it is. It is a game changer. Why? Because the new education policy was due for a long time. I think the one previous one was in 1986, if I'm not wrong. And after that, there were a lot of commissions which were done and a lot of new terminologies coined for various things in terms of education governance. The committees were like Yashpal committee, the committees were Hari Gautam committee, some of the reports surfaced here and there, some of them didn't come. Finally, we have the Kasturi Rangan committee, where our representation is also there, and they've done a good job in terms of bringing out what we call Nehra. The earlier versions, of course, have been used in bringing that out. The committee itself has taken probably 4, 5, 6 extensions as we kept reading in the newspaper, and also probably an extension of 1.5 to 2, because it was very voluminous. It needed to cater to all sets of diverse crowd, and therefore, I would say my appreciation for them, because it's such a tough job to do it. It's not easy. The policy which has come out primarily in the 400 pages almost covers all aspects of what education needs to deal, right from primary, secondary to the higher education, maybe continuing in the one beyond higher education also. So it's a very welcome step. We must compliment them. And as I've been telling that, there are lots of questions which have been raised after this has come into public. That includes me also, that I might have raised something here and there. But that is to add value to it, not to question the existence of NEP. And we did, in certain platforms, question the members whom we met in some forums like this. And one of the answers which I liked very much about the NEP policy itself is what I have started quoting on behalf of them. And number one was that that people ask them, why have you done this, or why have you not done this and that, and it's too ambitious and it's too big and like that. They ended up saying, why should our vision be limited? If you cannot implement something, it's left to you. Different states, different people, different institutions can lead to do different things. But why should we get limited by your vision? Vision should be a vision. We may achieve it in 10 years, 15 years, whatever. I think it is with this philosophy the committee has worked, and therefore hats off to them. The real good points which I've liked in the whole thing is, number one, the regulatory structure, which is getting redefined. And that's why this NERA will come into picture. We know that, and probably many of us who are involved in these things probably know that how many agencies or councils are there, and they're countering each other in terms of regulations or requirements. Or the most difficult thing is, some of the regulators come and say, I want a separate physical space, I want a separate building, separate library, separate playground, separate hostel. I think all that has to vanish if we have to call our universities as universities, otherwise we'll never be world class or high ranking. That's the limitation we will run. And this regulatory structure is probably going to be redefined if it is done well. My suggestion here would be, whichever the agency we have, NERA and various other things which are there, is fine. The other bodies which are in existence should define the professional part of it. Once I become an engineer, what do I do? Once I become a doctor, what do I do? Once I become an architect, what do I do? When it comes to education, some body which has been defined in this should be taking the control, seize the control. So that's a very appreciative point from my side. Can answer anything more on this if later there are certain questions which are there. Questions have been raised about 10,000 institutions giving the degrees. I think that's a big thing. Even now, handling 900 universities is a challenge. But once again, the answer is, why should the vision be limited? They have never specified 10,000 be in 10 years or 12 years or whatever. Last policy to this policy is 33 years now. So you can imagine this policy can also go for another 25, 30 years. It can be achieved. I think autonomy is the way forward for all of us. And this 10,000 institutions giving degrees will give them the freedom to make courses, choose courses, do examinations of different kind, various other things. And therefore, it's a welcome step. Even if it takes 20 years or 30 years, I won't mind. I think it should be done. That's the second positive. The third positive is already shared by some of my colleagues here on the dais, that the private and the public is going to be treated equally, at least on paper. We understand some differences. I've worked in government for 28 years. I understand that. But at least on paper, it's going to surface that, OK, they'll be treated equally. We know that in certain research cases, certain other cases, some major differentials are still there. But hopefully, over a period of time, it'll go away. I'm not necessarily promoting one over another, because I belong to both of them in a big way. But I will say that there should be a fair equality which should be given. Why? Because there was a time, not today, when 90% of engineering seats were sitting in the private domain. 91%, in fact, one analysis some 3-4 years back. Today, it might have changed again, but it was like that. So unless we handle the private sector or the self-financed education properly, probably will not be able to improve the quality. So in that sense, this is also very, very good step. And the last step, which I'll say, which I very briefly marked upon, was in my initial address there, was on the open education. The education is going to be opened up. It's not going to be an education that what teachers want to teach or institutions want to teach is being taught. It will be the other way around. What students want to learn would be learned. There'll be more higher emphasis on learning than less on teaching is what is going to be there. And therefore, that student centricity will come. Open learning will come. And that the new terminology which I shared with you, NACB, National Academic Credit Bank, would be one of the mainstays which will make it happen, that I can take my degree in 10 years rather than 3 or 4 years for engineering. I can do it anytime. I can go abroad, get few more credits. I can go to an accredited institution. I can go to some other institution which may be specialized. I can do skilling. And the normal taught courses, matching and mapping can be done. All can be done. That pipe of education, I actually started calling it pipe. You enter at first year, and after 4 years, you graduate. The pipe is a fully sealed pipe right now. And therefore, if you graduate in 4 years, fine. Maybe you can take it in 5-6 years also. But that pipe is now going to be leaky with multiple entry and multiple exits. It's not going to be input and output. It's going to be like that. And that will make the education really open. As I move along, I can change from mechanical to civil or civil to electronics if there is an opportunity and build my degree according to me. So these are some of the prime features, my dear friends, in the new education policy. My suggestion would be, let's come together and make sure that this policy becomes success. Unlike the previous ones, as I told you, that the NCHER failed, the HERA failed, various other versions were failing. Let's not put it to a difficulty. And why I'm saying this is, I think a figure given to us somewhere was that by 15th of August 2019, the feedback was to be given. I have also provided a lot of feedback on that. I think around 2 lakh inputs have been given back to the 5 or 6 member committee which is there. It will be a very daunting task for a committee or any other subcommittee to even look at that and absorb what is being said, because there is a lot of contradiction. I think we should digest all that. Whatever comes out in form of NEP should be acceptable, and from there we should move, because autonomy will help us to define our path in our own way later. That's the beauty of it. Thank you so much.
In the new educational policy, I could not see a multi-faculty university. Now in the country, and especially in Tamil Nadu, we have subject-wise university. Say for example, we have a music university, we have a physical education university, we have arts and science university, we have a medical university, engineering university. Why this country, especially only India, if you take even our own Asian countries, all of them are multi-faculty university. In order to have multi-faculty research, cross-disciplinary and also interdisciplinary research as well as teaching will happen only if we have multi-faculty university, where we have medical, engineering, agriculture, arts, fine arts, performing arts, everything. And that is why the new educational policy should provide a platform only for multi-faculty university, not for subject-wise university. This is my observation. And number two is that we say everybody, starting from Chairman AICT, quality, quality, quality. How do we bring in quality in higher education? And we have to very broadly deliberate how do we induct this quality in higher education, which is also another aspect. We have to deliberate and come out quality in teaching learning, quality in faculty induction, quality in research, quality in R&D. These are all the points I would like to say here. Thank you.